After I first watched The Empty Man, I was like, what? They made him out of, they manifested, what?
What the f*** is going on?
I know, I know. So let's break it down.
This is gonna be a good day.
What's going on, everyone? My name is Joe and this is Different Take. And today we're going to be explaining some movies. Comment down below some of your interpretations of The Empty Man because it's probably all gonna be different. Now, if you're watching this video, you probably most likely, most probably, probably have seen this movie before. So I don't have to warn you, but I will anyway. There's gonna be spoilers. The Empty Man, the movie, is about everything and nothing.
Already you're starting to lose me.
It's about how nothing really matters. Nothing. It's all about how you perceive it up here. It's about your perception, how certain people and certain things can influence the mind, essentially mind control, how the power of positive thinking and at the same time, the polar opposite, the power of negative thinking, can both have the same impact. Vulnerable people can be easily influenced and drawn to the light or the dark. All it takes is a couple of pushes this way and a couple of pushes that way.
Now he's a philosophizer.
In this movie, the influences of good or the light, the dark, evil influences are in stark contrast to each other, which is nothing new in movies. That's pretty much par for the course. But what's interesting is there are a lot of parallels between the two.
I have no idea what you're talking about.
So let's just get into this movie and break this movie down. So here we go. Movie opens up with a little or a big prologue, and we are in 1995 in Bhutan, in Ura Valley. We meet Greg and Paul and Fiona and Ruthie, and they're going hiking in Bhutan up this mountain, and they cross a very sketchy looking bridge. It's interesting to see how all four people handle their fear. Why? Because it is really all based on your perception. While those three are freaked out, Greg's just sort of trotting along the bridge like, hey, come on. Hey, it's good times. Let's go. Get used to seeing bridges. This is one of many bridges. There's bridges all over this damn movie. They get across and Paul, looking like little Steven, hears some ringing and not the kind from Polar Express. And he's just like, what in the hell is that? Whoop! And just completely just falls down the damn crevasse. And it's because they're like, you okay down there, buddy? It's like, no, he just fell down a damn crevasse in the mountain. Empty Man is looking like Skeletor sitting there like a baseball catcher, like,
all right, chuck it in there, baby. Chuck it in there, baby. Come on.
They're wandering, trying to get help, and they find an abandoned cabin in the middle of nowhere. Oh, this cannot be good. This is never good.
Yeah, no.
Ruthie finds a little flute on Paul, a little Yaz flute. Greg finds some scars on Paul's wrist. We can kind of see why Paul was hearing the ringing, because he is a good vessel for the Empty Man. He's obviously going through some stuff. Greg says to Fiona, it's not his head, but in his head. Zombie. Ruthie sees someone or something outside the cabin, and she goes outside. Why? No. What are you doing? Ruthie and this like shadow-like figure proceed to play a game of red light, green light. Now Ruthie runs in the cabin and out of harm's way, for now. Later on, while Ruthie is sleeping, Paul is in her ear, sound like a goddamn coffee drip, like that sound was driving me completely bonkers. She wakes up and finds Paul missing. They go out to look for him and they find Paul sitting in front of the bridge. Paul breathes something out and it looks like at the same time, Ruthie breathes something in. Now, Ruthie pulls out a knife and kills Greg. What? I liked Greg. And then kills Fiona. All right, now you done cross the line, because I really liked Fiona. It looks like Paul is controlling her and telling her what to do telepathically. Ruthie just is sitting there and she just falls off the ledge. And if you look at Paul, he has a little teardrop. It's as if Paul is in there somewhere and had to watch helplessly as his friends get killed by his girlfriend, and his girlfriend just falls off a cliff. No, not a good time. It's kind of like there's some symbolism there with someone who maybe is dealing with depression or addiction, watching as the people around you, like you're bringing the people down around you, and you know you're doing it, but you're kind of helpless to sort of help yourself. 20 plus minutes in, we get some titles. Yay, titles, 20 plus minutes in. That was a long prologue, Jesus. Mary and Joseph. We're in 2018 in Webster Mills, Missouri. We're introduced to our main character, James LaSombra.
I get all that, I grew up in San Francisco. Please, I grew up in San Francisco.
James meets up with Amanda and we meet Amanda, who suspiciously looks like Will from Stranger Things. Twinning, now it's established that he knows Amanda pretty well. He knows her mom even better. Now, the conversation that they have is very important. It's one of the most important parts of the movie.
Nothing can hurt you because nothing is real. What's real starts here and ends up out here. What we think about with focus and intention and repetition, we manifest. It's the power of positive thinking, the power of negative thinking, right?
It's like, if you think it, if you believe it, you'll make it happen.
It's an interesting phrase.
Amanda's mom, Nora, wakes up to find Amanda missing. You see that Amanda is going through some stuff too. Her dad died 2 years ago. She's having some panic attacks. Later on, James is on the bridge, another bridge, and he finds an open manhole. Manhole, empty man. I see what you did there, movie. Later, Devara is at her home, I guess, and she's has a sauna. Who the hell can afford a sauna? Devara gets stabbed by, what, a dark figure? But then there's some scenes where you see she's doing it to herself. What? I don't know what's going on here. Even James says to the cop,
people just don't do that to themselves.
I agree, James.
You know this town. One, two murders a year. Now this poisons the atmosphere. It's communicable. It changes people.
Now, at this time, they're showing a vigil going on, and just remember this scene for later. Later on, James is listening to the audio interview with Devara.
On the first night, you'd hear him. The second night, you'd see him. On the third night, you'd feel him.
It's like the thing with Amanda earlier. What you think about with focus and intention and repetition, you manifest. If you think it, you believe it, you'll make it happen. Now, James researches the Pontifex Institute, or the Pontifex Institute. Pontifex. It's a stretch, but you know what? Whatever. I'm going with it.
Okay.
He's looking at the Pontifex Society. He stumbles across the TOPA formula. James tries to sleep and he can't sleep. Wakes up and just happens to be at 3 a.m. Always in movies that happens, wake up at 3 a.m., something bad. You wake up at 2 in the morning, it's, hey, he can't sleep. All of a sudden now it's 3 a.m. It's like, oh, something bad's going to happen. Now James starts hearing things in the dark and shadows start messing with his head and he grabs a bat. Attaboy, James, grab that bat. That's a smart thing to do. James goes to the Pontifex Institute to investigate. And when he's walking in, look at the literature to the left. Also look at the questions on the registration form.
Hi, what is this?
Based off of these questions, they can kind of tell if like you're an independent critical thinker or a captive mind, which is an uncritical imitative mind.
Just make yourself comfortable. I'm sure you'll find the answers you're looking for.
A lot of times this happens in this movie where a lot of vague things are being said or happening that can apply to multiple things. It can be thought of as very ominous. At the same time, it could apply to someone just walking in looking for help. Now we see this speaker/preacher at Pontifex. It's like every vague religious support group jargon. It could apply to so many different people and so many different things. It's like he's saying a lot, but he's not really saying anything. Now, what the preacher/speaker says to James is super, super important.
We're each of us blind in our way.
How people's perception can kind of blind them from the reality of situations.
Distractions rob us of focus. Technology robs us of memory. Repetition robs us of comprehension. You know, the child's game. If you say your name enough times, it becomes gibberish. Take Nietzsche's old line, if you stare into an abyss, it also stares into you. That has been rendered meaningless through repetition. So the question becomes, if profound meaning can be robbed of something by so simple a task as repetition, which is more fundamental, which is more true? Your name or the gibberish? That is the empty man.
That's some good stuff right there. So a profound meaning can be robbed by repetition.
Now, my plan is for my plan to work. But you know what they say about the best laid plans, right? But, said plan too many times. Words lost all its meaning now.
That also works the other way around. Repetition can give gibberish profound meaning.
There's an invisible man living in the sky who watches everything you do every minute of every day.
But he loves you.
It's like we manifested a guy. I'm not real, I'm manifested. In this movie, they start to say that over and over and over and over again. You start to kind of go, did he really get manifested from just thought? You have to remember, no, it's gibberish. It's completely ridiculous. That doesn't make any sense. That's not happening. What, it just, you say it so many times, you start to believe it.
What is an abyss? And if you stare into it, why? What about it calls to you? If it stares into you, it stands to reason something in you must also be calling to it.
Now, a couple things are happening here. He's explaining the complexity of Nietzsche's line. He's also getting James to question what is real and planting ideas in his head, so he's more receptive and open to the abyss and or empty man calling out to him. He's planting these ideas in his head like, you're special, you're chosen, you must be special to the void for that darkness to be calling to you. Don't be afraid of it and whatever. It's like, no.
I'm so glad you came back.
Never been here before.
Stop planting ideas in my head there, preacher. Stop messing with me, dude. James goes to this camp slash cabin, goes through these files and sees his file. But note, it's empty. I see that as like a metaphor for there's no thoughts in there. He has nothing in his head as far as the thoughts they're trying to plant in his head. Nothing. You see this dark cult group just walking around this big fire thing. It's creepy as hell. But interestingly enough, it's also parallel to the vigil in the park. They're identical to each other. They're just going in different directions and they're all dressed differently. But they're essentially doing the same thing. Later on in the night, he's trying to sleep. He has nightmares. He wakes up at 3 a.m. again. Then gets attacked by some killer laundry. Next morning, he wakes up and he does not take his prescription. What is his prescription? Doxepin. What is doxepin? It's an antidepressant and nerve pain medication. It can treat depression, anxiety, insomnia, and other sleep disorders. James has some sleep deprivation. He's not taking his meds now. Careful, James. You're opening yourself up, dude. James goes to the Pontifex Institute. James finds a binder. Now it has all the information. It's like all those thoughts and all those ideas that are being planted throughout the entire movie, for now, they're up here. All the files are in the folder now. James is all freaking out now. He goes to the hospital.
Maybe you could just tell me about that guy in that room.
Maybe they were treating him experimentally and he took a turn.
A turn?
Took a turn for the worse. Maybe he took a turn for the better.
There it is again. See, every time someone in this movie says something being bad or good, they almost always follow it up with the polar opposite. It's like it doesn't really matter. Nothing really matters. It could be good, it could be bad. James finds Amanda in the room with Paul.
You can call him whatever you'd like. I like to think of him as a carrier because he's like a disease in a way, but he's also like a carrier signal, you know?
No, Amanda, he doesn't know. We don't know. That's why he's asking you, you knucklehead.
Modulated by an input signal. He transmits, we receive, and his message is contagious.
I need to call your mom.
He calls Nora, and apparently whoever answers, they act like they don't know who he is. Or maybe Nora did answer, and that's just what James heard. Because there's an evil, empty man in the room with him, and it's like this stuff can be thrown off like that. We find out Paul is getting weak, and he only has so long left. They need a replacement, so they tried something radical, an experiment.
It's getting hard to tell what's real and what's in your head anymore, isn't it?
Not real!
Of course it's not, so why fight it? You must detach from a false reality in order to attach to a new one, a stronger one.
Now you can easily flip that around. You must detach from your actual reality in order to attach a new one, a fake one, a false reality.
We made you as a group. The signal can only penetrate through the cracks of sorrow, grief, and guilt, fear. That's what we were missing.
That's why Paul was a carrier. That's why Amanda was tapping into it. And this is why James is a potential vessel.
Nothing you do is in your control. You cannot make your own choices. You're not your own man. You're our man. Isn't that a relief, really? So just let go. Wouldn't it be easier?
James, you gotta fight it, dude. Don't buy that bullshit she's selling you. But when he's not on his meds and he's sleep deprived and he's, you know, depressed, he's like, who am I? Who am I? I don't know who I am.
I'm James.
James, get out of there. James really starts questioning his reality and who he really is. And he just completely lets go. Ah, damn. He then starts seeing visions of like the conjuring session, and all of a sudden Amanda is there. What? No, she wasn't. She wasn't there. He's seeing what the empty man wants him to see. James starts seeing visions of his memories and his house, which is now empty. But it's not real. It's not real, James. You let him in, dude. This is what happens. You let him in. He shoots Paul. Then he walks out to the doctors and the nursing staff. They all bow to him, I guess. They're a part of the society. Damn healthcare system at work right there. Ooh, roll credits. So what happened there? Was James really just manifested from thought and focus? Or was he just Jedi mind tricked because he was in a vulnerable state? Both.
What?
It is really all based on your perception. Whether it's positive, negative, in the middle, doesn't matter. How you view this movie is essentially what you get from it. I personally tend to go with the fact that he was manipulated, which means he was still technically manifested with thought and focus, but he was manifested up here, mentally. See, just like the society got James to question his reality and got him to believe that he is this manifested vessel, the director is getting the audience to question James's reality and believe that he really is this manifested vessel. So based on your perception, positive or negative, what you think about with focus and intention and repetition, you manifest. The power of positive thinking, the power of negative thinking. It works both ways. It is all based on your perception. If you like my explanation of The Empty Man, don't forget to like and subscribe. Follow me on social media for all channel updates in the in-between time. Thank you so much for watching, and I will see you in the next one. Peace, y'all.
Thank you, Salim, and take it away.